Hello everybody. Just a little video for prep for basic biology. It's just giving a little introduction to the scientific method, helping to cultivate some proper way of thinking about science and how to ask appropriate questions. This is for part three in the online handout. We'll help you answer those questions. When you're done with this little video, you should be able to ask the appropriate question. In a biological sense, be able to analyze an experiment that is provided in here. We'll talk about that a little bit. And you should be able to start setting up your own experiments and include those proper variables. So let's kind of look at what the scientific method is. We'll review this. This was already covered in chapter one. But simply put, the scientific method is just a set of guidelines or rules that allows scientists to properly explore and understand any scientific phenomena. You explore these concepts in chapter one. You watch that video on scientific variables, answered all the questions that went along with that. We're going to briefly review the steps. When you're looking at this diagram and when you're understanding the steps of the scientific method, you should be aware that any text you look at, they might have slight variations into this model. There are some important concepts that you're going to see over and over again anytime you look at the steps of the scientific method. So you're always going to want to ask a question. You're going to analyze that question, do some background research to understand your topic. Importantly, you're going to construct a hypothesis. In our class, we try to use this if-then statement that we've talked about already, and it'll discuss that in the handout. If then statements will give you a proper way to test that hypothesis. So you design your experiment to appropriately assess the hypothesis, perform that experiment, analyze the results, and draw conclusions. If the hypothesis is supported, you report the results. If the hypothesis is not supported, you can still report those results, but you want to try to modify that hypothesis. So this is a continuous effort in science to explore any phenomena, try to understand what is going on in the world. So planning an experiment is a very important part. You've already now analyzed, developed your hypothesis. Now you want to plan an experiment. Most experiments are going to have two groups associated with it. You need to have a way to determine if the thing you are manipulating actually changes something, changes that dependent variable. So you need to have that experimental group, the thing you're manipulating, the thing you're changing. For example, if you're looking at the effects of fertilizer on plant growth, very simple experiment, you need to have a group that gets the fertilizer. This would be your experimental group. But how would you know if that fertilizer actually aided the plants in growth? You would need a baseline. This is where your control group comes into play. This provides a baseline. This would be a group, every condition stays the same. In the two groups, the one thing you're changing, that independent variable, is nitrogen or is fertilizer. That's what you're going to give to that experimental group. The control group would not receive it. A good experiment is going to have more than one set of data. So you're going to have more than one plant. We'll kind of work on that when we get to setting up your own experiments. But this helps to remove any problems, any errors that may occur. You can average a lot of data together. You're going to define dependent and independent variables, and you're going to test that hypothesis. Oops, notice there's a little spelling typo in there. Should say hypothesis with an S on the end, but you're going to test that hypothesis. This is planning a good experiment, and we're going to work towards this during this week two, and we'll talk more about it when we get into the other parts and when we work on it in the face-to-face meeting. We'll start with a little example into the scientific method. This is an old experiment in microbiology, very cool, very interesting experiment to really help refute this idea of spontaneous generation. Briefly, what spontaneous generation stated is living things were able to form from non-living entities. Now, as college students, you may have ordered some pizza delivery, ate a couple slices, left it sit out. Well, after a few days, you might notice some mold bacteria growing on the pizza. The pizza wasn't living, but now we have these living things all over it. People once thought that this living material could have just spontaneously formed from that non-living matter. We understand now that there are bacteria all over the place, can in the air, on our hands, that can fall off land on the back on the pizza and start to grow. It wasn't always this way, and Louis Pasteur, in his famous swan neck flask experiment, helped to refute this hypothesis of spontaneous generation. So he made a hypothesis in this if-then format. If living organisms are derived from air and do not spontaneously generate, then bacteria should not grow in the swan neck flask. This was his hypothesis. He set it up appropriately. If you looked in that picture, on the left, you have a flask containing some bacterial growth media. It's like basically chicken broth. Some nice energy source. On the top, you'll notice this S-shaped or swan-shaped cylinder that goes to the top. It's open to the air, that allows air to exchange back and forth. On the right side, you'll notice the same flask without that swan neck. So the thing you're manipulating here, you're changing the type of flask. And what he noticed, he sterilized both. There was no life inside of the flask in either situation. The flask with the swan neck, after many weeks, did not grow anything living. The flask that was open to the air without the swan neck, in less than a day, was teeming with living organisms. So what do you suppose this means? How did he analyze these results? So his experiment, very nice, very neat experiment. He had an independent variable, dependent variable. I'm not going to specifically tell you what these are. It's your job to help to be able to identify those different variables. He had his control group and he had his experimental group. In conclusion, his hypothesis was supported that swan neck flask did not have any bacterial growth in it. That supported the hypothesis. His analysis of this, his conclusion was that the bacteria were present in the air. In the swan neck, they got trapped at the bottom of that first loop. In this first loop, the bacteria got trapped and were not able to get up and back into the flask. When that swan neck was removed, they would fall directly into the media from the air and then start to grow. So he has a nice analysis, and this is what we know happens to living things now and how living things are derived from other previously living organisms. So what I want you to be able to do now, so analyze that first experiment, and now you want to be able to plan your own experiment. This is not an experiment that's going to be performed. It's just developing questions, developing hypotheses, and developing some sort of experiment, including your independent, dependent variables, and your control and experimental groups or variable groups. So you want to just come up with some idea, make some observations, ask some question, provide a hypothesis using that if-then statement, indicate those different variables and those different groups. This is what you want to do for this part of the assignment. Helps you to understand the scientific method. It should be nothing complicated. It doesn't have to be really anything too deep. Something simple enough where you can define these different parameters. After that, you can move on to part four. And in part four of your online handout, you are going to look at a plant experiment. You're going to come up with a question. We are going to perform plant experiments throughout the semester. So we're just going to start by posing some questions and maybe coming up with some good ideas. You'll work in groups on your experiments, but right now, individually, I want you to pose a question. Write it in the handout. When you're done writing it in the handout, you'll want to post it to the discussion board. And then also comment on a peer's question that they're asking about plants. Give some constructive criticism. Maybe it's good, maybe it could use some improvement, but maybe it's interesting and you just want to let somebody know that their question is a good question, an interesting question. We'll create some online community there. When you're done with part four, then we will meet. Hopefully your handout will be completed. It needs to be completed to enter the classroom. We'll have our discussion. We'll work through some material, get into groups and work on designing an experiment. And when all of that is done, then you can work on the quiz. You'll have two attempts on the quiz. And once again, there's really no timetable for the quiz. It's just take it when you start to understand the material. Ideally, you'll have all of these quizzes completed prior to taking the exam at the end of Unit 1. If you have any questions, come to the face-to-face chat with them and we can go over any questions that you have. But with that, we'll stop this little chat. Hopefully you have a good idea of what's going on in this Week 2 online handout and you have a good understanding of the scientific method. Good luck and we'll see you next week.